respected delegates, Dr. Nayana Vijayavardhane, senior lecturer in veterinary clinical studies, head of the department, Department of Veterinary Clinical Science, Faculty of Veterinary Medicine and Animal Science, University of Peradeniya, Sri Lanka. Nayana graduated as a veterinarian from the Faculty of Veterinary Medicine and Animal Sciences, University of Peradeniya in Sri Lanka. She obtained her PhD in clinical pharmacology from Auburn University, United States of America in 2007. She then joined the University of Peradeniya as a senior lecturer in veterinary clinical sciences. She led the curriculum revision and implementation committee of the Faculty of Veterinary Medicine and Animal Sciences, partnering with the Massey University of New Zealand under the OIE Twinning Program to revise the BVSC curriculum to align with the international veterinary curricula. She is the head of Department of Veterinary Clinical Sciences in the Faculty of Veterinary Medicine and Animal Sciences, University of Peradeniya. Other than her role as a senior veterinary clinician in the veterinary teaching hospital, her second most interested field of expertise is the veterinary education. She has been trained by several veterinary educationists from Massey University of New Zealand and University of Melbourne, Australia, over the development of the veterinary curricula. She also serves as the regional associate from Sri Lanka to work in the Council of International Veterinary Medical Education, established under the Association of American Veterinary Medical Colleges. She is a fellow in College of Veterinary Surgeon in Sri Lanka from 2013. With these few words, I am welcoming Dr. Nayana Vijayavardhane to the seminar. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Justin. Now I invite Dr. Anoop, Associate Professor, Department of Veterinary Surgery and Radiology, College of Veterinary and Animal Science, Pannuthi, and to address the gathering.
Okay. So good evening to everyone. As all of us know, though there are a lot of new and new zoonotic diseases are emerging up, rabies still continues to be one of the most deadly zoonotic diseases in the developing and also the underdeveloped countries. Not only is trade-offs, even pet dogs also can be a source of the infection to the public. So there comes the importance of responsible pet ownership or pet parenting, where vets have the responsibility to educate or inculcate the habit of responsible pet owners in the public. And thereby they will continue doing vaccination and protecting their animals, and not only their animal, the public also. And vets also have the responsibility of controlling the stray dog population, control the rabies. And today we have a Madam Nayana, is a very an expert, a clinician, and we are here to hear from you about the measures and methods what the Sri Lankan government is taking to control the diseases like brooding rabies and other zoonotic diseases also. And I trust the presentation will be so worth for all the PG students and also all the participants for the seminar. And I think we are fortunate to have you here, madam. Welcome to the conference.
Thank you so much, sir. Now I invite Dr. Professor Dr. Shyam K. Venugopal, sir, Provost and Head, University Veterinary Hospital, Kokkale, to speak few words, and I am handing over the session to sir.
And my dear sir, Dr. Maya, Dr. Sunil, Dr. Justin, Dr. Sunil Kumar, others. And definitely a very warm good evening to Dr. Nayana, my good old friend. Welcome to Kerala. Now, good to come to Kerala, but we hope you'll be here soon. And I am extremely thankful to the organizers for inviting me and making me the chair of this session. And I am extremely happy to be the chair of this session, especially because my good old friend Dr. Nayana is delivering the lecture. Dr. Nayana is a very experienced clinician. She is very much experienced in veterinary education field also. So at some point of time, we may have to utilize her expertise in veterinary education field. She is experienced worldwide, US, Australia, New Zealand, etc., etc. So we may have to utilize her. So it is a nice topic she is talking to us. She is talking to us about responsible dog ownership, especially to our Kerala people. I often feel that our people are not very responsible about our dog ownership. We keep dogs, but we are not very much concerned about the well-being of the dog as well as the well-being of the general public. So I think Nayana will be elaborating more on these topics. This topic will really help our veterinarians, veterinary students, everybody. So I am happy to invite Dr. Nayana Vigodhanene to deliver her immense experience and wisdom to us. Dr. Nayana.
Thank you very much, Professor Shyam and Anu, for hosting me for the keynote address for this session. I'm feeling really honored and privileged to talk for this audience, very prestigious audience. And I will be just explaining a nutshell of what I have learned over the last years when I worked as a veterinary clinician and a practitioner together with the clinical teacher. So let me share my slideshow with the audience. And if you have any disturbance in hearing or viewing my presentation, please let me know in the chat box. Responsible dog ownership or the animal ownership is a concern for veterinary associations globally. Whether it's India or Sri Lanka or US, I don't think there's any difference. There are various opinions about the place of animals in society. There is ongoing debate over legal state animal ownership and where matters related to animals might or might not have a place within the legal system. No matter what the opinions might be regarding animal ownership and various rights that might be claimed, there are always responsibilities associated with everybody who owns and manages animals for whatever reason. The veterinary profession is in a unique situation and can play a vital role in encouraging and promoting responsible animal ownership globally. Education about all aspects of animal ownership is something that we can do on a daily basis. In order to better understand how a veterinarian can facilitate in amalgamating these societal needs, I'm trying to discuss the first part of my presentation on understanding the responsible pet ownership. And in the second part of my presentation, even though it was not mentioned before, I'll be discussing as veterinarians how we may contribute by responsible pet ownership to eliminate rabies, a fatal disease in most of the southeastern countries which are overwhelmed with. Whilst invoking responsible dog ownership appears to have considerable merit, its lack of specifics and potential for individual interpretation limits its use as a campaigning message. Responsible dog ownership may be interpreted differently by people and between groups and over time. As you can see here clearly, there are limits for using this as a campaigning message because there are the potentials for individual interpretation and also due to its lack of specificity. Responsible dog ownership may be interpreted differently between people, between groups, and over time, as I mentioned before. One good example is that muzzling was at one time a legally enforceable action to prevent the spread of rabies, and it became a badge of a well-cared for dog and responsible owner. Over time, several arguments meant cruel muzzles, then replaced by the expectation of using a leash. In the ideals of responsible ownership practice continues to evolve as dogs become more integrated into the family in a humanized way. Responsible dog ownership means different things to different at different times. It comes from a blurred intersection of needs of dogs, needs of owners, and needs of others, whereas often the dog comes first. Dog owners, they perceive to be best for their individual dog, even if this goes against general advice given, such as how often dog needs walking or neutering campaigns. Yet, this perception may be different from what others feel is best for that dog, or how people who are impacted by the dog want the dog and their owner to behave. As to promote behavior change, which is the crucial aspect of the responsible ownership, it's simply telling the owners, there's no simply telling the owners that they should be responsible of limited use, because they already believe that they are doing responsible, they are behaving responsible. Thus, we need to be specific. As veterinarians, we should to educate them how specific they should be, what are the things we should specifically do for the pets. The construction of responsibility include appropriate nutrition and exercise, removing its feces from public places, neutering, correct identification and microchipping, and taking care of the dog health and well-being. These descriptions appear to be underpinned by a desire to make owners behave in certain ways that are perceived by various stakeholders as good practice. The responsible dog ownership is always a multifaceted social phenomenon, which is embedded with the use of codes, do this or don't do this. So it tends to shape daily human and animal interactions. Because of that, it evolves day by day in different angles, and we are seeing new things are coming up. The existing things are waning away. So therefore, this is an evolving process. The responsibility requires, in order to recognize an issue and know what can be done about it, and then act responsibly. However much we say and however much we do, persons' beliefs and motivations are the things which will determine the responsible dog ownership. The same way, the dog owner behavior regarded as irresponsible is also a sequelae to that. rather than intention to maliciously cause problems, they do it because they think that is the right thing for their animal. As I mentioned previously, requires knowledge in order to recognize an issue. And also, responsibility requires knowledge to know and what can be done about it and act responsibly. Further, it also requires capacity to respond across the added complexity of human-animal encounter. It often relies on being able to control the behavior of the dog. The term is discussions involving an increase in dog attacks to people, a rise in cases of animal cruelty, reports of abandoned strays, and disgust over dog fouling and zoonotic diseases risk. When it becomes a societal problem, increasing societal dog problem, this perception, the perception of an increasing societal dog problem has brought the term responsible dog ownership or dangerous dogs into focus. For politicians and campaigning groups, this has been one of the focus. It has established the view that the key to tackling this problem is being owner. In recent times, there have been serious global concerns about pet overpopulation, with a resultant increase in the number of animals euthanized by animal shelters. Debates continue to explore the relative contribution of uncontrolled animal breeding to the increased annual euthanasia of animals. Studies have blamed the breakdown of human-animal bond and not increased reproduction for the annual increase in pet euthanasia, insinuating that the increasing effort to reduce breeding might actually be misinformed. In addition to this, failure to neuter pets inadvertently leads to pet overpopulation. Even though it is not a major cause of overpopulation, the sterilization of pets not required for breeding may be considered controversial or even illegal in some countries. It has been reported that neutering and spaying male and female dogs and cats reduces reproductive diseases and consequently undesirable breeding-related behaviors, thereby strengthening bonds between pets and their owners. It has also been suggested that sterilization may increase pet longevity. That sterilization of pets, as we all know, however, is not without its shortcomings. For example, urinary, prostate, and some orthopedic problems have been frequently associated with spaying. There are demographic differences due to cultural, religion, and ethnic population of dogs and cats, which are owned by the more affluent segment of society who can afford veterinary care, are obtainable from veterinarians. However, the same cannot be applied for pets from underserved communities. It has been inferred that this population of pets has to own pets, feral animals, wildlife, livestock, as well as human population, So in which rabies is one of the major devastating problem for all of our countries, especially in Southeastern Asia. Therefore, from this onwards, let me focus on the fundamentals of rabies eradication, which is one of the OIE intentions and as well as one of the key responsibilities on the shoulder of the veterinarians. Rabies is one of significant to Sri Lanka due to its endemic status and its high socio-economic impact. Being a small island, well placed to the first in there have been significant roadblocks in the issue is overshadowed by the fearful response to the disease among the public, administrators, and at times even professionals. Obstacles to eradication include conflict between human and veterinary health sectors, the high cost of effective eradication and resultant among political will, and tangible support required to scale up the national up to the national level. Of major constraint are the widespread opinions and misconceptions about the methodology of rabies elimination. The principles are straightforward in the elimination of rabies. As veterinarians, we should all have a clear and thorough understanding of these so we can speak or lobby with one voice so that we take actions and lead in one unified direction towards eradication of rabies. The first premise is that rabies elimination is feasible. Next, a shift which needs broad acceptance is that rabies eradication must focus on disease elimination in the reservoir host, the domestic dog. The third misunderstanding that must be accepted is that wildlife rabies is not of important if no, is of not importance in rabies elimination. The fourth principle of rabies elimination is that rabies spread is not dependent on the density or the number of the dog population. To clarify the relationship between density and disease transmission, the concept of basic reproduction ratio is indicated in RO must be understood. Reproduction ratio, number of new individuals infected by one rabid dog during its entire infectious period in a population which is fully susceptible. Reducing reproduction ratio below one is what we know in our elimination campaigns. For canine rabies, the reproductive ratio value is consistently between 1 and 2 in dog populations across the world, despite wide variation in dog population densities and demographic characteristics. In addition, studies have shown that canine rabies can circulate where densities are as low as 1.36 dogs per square kilometer. Behaviorally, social animals that they seek out conspecifics even where density is low. Thus, reduction of population to below these thresholds are not practically achievable or even useful. Therefore, the role of dog population control efforts in rabies eradication program is not focused on dog population density reduction, but rather an attempt to reduce population turnover, which in other words, new vaccinated dogs entering the population, and thus vaccination effort required to maintain herd immunity. The concept that needs to be clearly understood is that of herd immunity. These underlying principles are understood, the fundamental elements for planning effective rabies elimination are straightforward and well established. The focus of rabies elimination must be vaccination campaigns. Evidence clearly shows that herd immunity for rabies is achieved with 70% vaccine of all dogs on and roaming. So, what does it take to conduct a good vaccination campaign? The first principle is that maintain 70% vaccine for this population count. If you do not know your initial population, you cannot calculate the percentage vaccination coverage. The dogs that are most important for vaccinate are those with the highest chance of encountering a rabid dog. This is primarily roaming dogs. In addition, the vaccinated roaming dogs serve as a first line of defense barrier between the invading rabid dog and the pet dogs, thus reducing potential human exposures. To maintain herd immunity, gain maximum benefit from the vaccination effort, these vaccinated animals should not be culled or removed from the population. The next principle is that ad hoc and scattered vaccination programs are of no value. The same principle applies to the sterilization efforts as well. Shown that elimination is dependent on high level of contiguous vaccination, and even small pockets of low coverage can cause a significant delay in progress. Next comes to the vaccine quality. Vaccination quality is critical. Internationally recognized, WHO recommended rabies vaccine is of extraordinary efficacy, and with US Federal Drug Administration certification of 3-year DOI. The key is that these vaccines provide a high immunistic response even with a low serum antibody or infrequent boosters. This is of enormous benefit in large-scale vaccination efforts, considering the labor, cost, and time intensiveness in these programs, and significantly impacts achievement and maintenance of herd immunity. A barrier to achieving and maintaining immunity is high turnover of dog populations. Thus, the role of sterilization in rabies control is focused on density reduction. Instead, it's an attempt to reduce population turnover, and in turn, the vaccination effort required to maintain herd immunity. Sterilization programs aimed at stabilizing patients also impact the nuisance aspect, which is, if not effectively addressed, will often result in government officials removing vaccinated roaming dogs, undermining herd immunity and rabies control efforts. It must also be remembered that 70% contiguous for female dog sterilization coverage is required. Ad hoc programs are cost and little value for rabies or population control, though the individual animal welfare benefit is clear. To minimize population turnover and maintain required herd immunity, it is important to keep the vaccinated and sterilized dogs alive as long as possible. Effective surveillance is a component of any disease eradication campaign. A recent proposal by FAO, OIE and WHO is the concept of integrated management, increasing the number and location of diagnostic laboratory facilities and test technologies is important for effective eradication. The public can be informed and supportive of rabies eradication efforts. For effective eradication of rabies, the public must be engaged, as I mentioned earlier. However, the economics of rabies control program have been looked at in a more detail recently. A meticulously planned, well implemented, and integrated multi-stakeholder program is necessary, fundamental to ensuring real progress towards rabies eradication. It also requires significant and well resource allocation and funding. However, this expenditure will not see immediate, but rather economic and social gains. The concerted political will combined with adequate financial investment is required if to become a reality in Sri Lanka as well as globally in countries where rabies is a problem. So it's challenging. It is an opportunity to place Sri Lanka as well as most of the other Southeast Asian countries in a lead position in the current global rabies control in developing region. Before I thank everyone, veterinarians, let me elaborate you. All we all have in educating the public and husbandry of any animal is best obtained from a veterinary profession. Furthermore, the veterinary profession can provide independent science educators about the most appropriate legislation and regulation of animals and animal owners. For example, legislation about dangerous drugs is under active consideration with input from the legislative bodies. Therefore, it should be our passion. It should be the passion of the veterinarians to encourage the public for responsible pet owners. Thank you very much. Dr. Anup, I'm done with the presentation.
Okay, thank you, madam. Dr. Irshad.
Hello.
Dr. Irshad.
Yes, madam. Shyam sir. Hello, sir, please.
Okay, madam. Thanks a lot for the nice presentation. So I have a question for you.
Yes.
So you said that sterilization is banned in some of the countries, right? Is there any country in Southeast Asia where sterilization program is banned?
Not in Southeast Asian countries, but in some European countries, it's banned. Not in Southeast Asian countries.
Thank you very much, for madam, for the nice presentation. So I cannot see any questions in the chat box also. Hope there is no participants have some doubt.
Hi, sir. Can I ask a doubt?
Yeah, sure.
Ma'am, I'm Lena. I've just completed my undergraduate course. And I just wanted to ask a doubt that is regarding being responsible dog owners. What do you think we as veterinarians could advise dog owners, that is regarding their handling during puppyhood, so that during visits to the vets, they are more easy to handle for the vets, because most often we see that the dogs will only allow handling or such handling by the owners, only their owner as such, and once the veterinarian just proceeds to approach the dog, they will turn very defensive, and some even not even allow their owners to handle them as well. So is there something that we can do while you know raising them in the puppyhood itself, something we can advise owners to do?
The last part wasn't clear, Lena. Can you just explain it?
Ma'am, what I was asking was, as veterinarians, is there something that we can advise dog owners to do? I mean, in a way that they can handle their puppies from the puppyhood itself, from the period of socialization itself, so that it becomes easier for us to handle them during their visits to the vet, because most often they become very defensive and won't allow handling by the pets, and some even don't allow their owners to handle.
Yeah, it's a good question. Thank you for the posting the question, Lena. So as vets, I think the Southeast Asian countries have not gone for dog training programs yet. I think it's high time we should move for that. From the puppyhood, if we can, direct them for dog training, it is a must. So, and in addition to that, till we move on to that level, as veterinarians, we can advise them, or we can train them while we are in with us. Now, if we are in a clinic, we can simply take them a tour of how to handle a puppy with very non-invasive methods, and also we can simply train them. In addition to that, what I have seen is certain the practitioners actually they organize some training programs like to educate their clients. Did I answer your question?
Yeah, ma'am, definitely. That was informative. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Hope there is no more doubts from the participants. So I thank Naina Madam for being here and giving a wonderful lecture. Thank you, Madam, for your time.
Thank you, Dr. Anu.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, Naina Madam. It was a very informative and elaborative sessions on responsible dog ownership. And thank you very much, Dr. Shyam K. Venugopal sir, Professor and Head University Veterinary Hospital, Kakale, for giving a wonderful introduction. And also co-chair, Dr. S. Anoop, Associate Professor, Department of Veterinary Surgery and Radiology, College of Veterinary and Animal Science, Mannanthi, on behalf of Kerala Veterinary and Animal Science University and Indian Veterinary Association, I would like to thank Dr. Naina, Dr. Shyam K. Venugopal, and Dr. Anoop for making this particular session a memorable one.